Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome this morning to the house of the Lord. Why don't we all stand together as we come in and as we worship him this morning, for he is our King and our Creator. Let's praise him for what he's done for us and what he's going to do for us this morning.
Father, we're thankful, Lord, today for the opportunity that we have again to be able to gather here and to worship you. Father, it's our desire that you would be honored, that you would be lifted up. It's our desire, Father, that that the praises that we sing and the voices that we lift, that these would be pleasing in your sight and you would be honored, that Father, so much so that you would inhabit the praises of your people. Father, we ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would lead us. Holy Spirit, we recognize your presence here, and we ask that you would tear down the barriers that squeeze you out and tear down the barriers that dull your voice and help us to hear, to know, to understand. Father, we commit this time into your hands. Be glorified in this place. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Jesus. song this morning. It's exciting, and I know it's always hard to sing the new song right off the bat, but just watch the words about God is fighting for us. He is on our side. There's nothing that He can't handle, even if we can't.
Jesus, you are here. God is
announcements are in our bulletins, and there's a couple of lengthy announcements. As I was writing, I thought, I'm writing too much. But this week at Impact Kids, we were able to share with the kids how much money they raised for goats. And it was interesting to see them, because we have a list of the different livestock that you can buy through Nazarene Compassionate Ministries. And I think under each livestock, they want to buy everything. So, you know, back when we were raising money for chicks, they were able to buy chicks, two hens, and a rooster. So with the goats, you had an option of buying a young goat, a mature goat, or a pair of mature goats. And they had enough money to buy it all. So now, they've challenged themselves to raise money for a female calf, which is $300. But underneath that, you can buy a cow, and it's $600. So there are some of the older kids who are really hoping that we'll be able to raise $900 to buy both the female calf and the cow. But it's just amazing to see God at work and to see God working in their lives. I think I shared a few weeks ago back there was one little boy when we started this. He went home and he broke his piggy bank so that he could bring money in to raise money. And of course, there's some competition amongst the teams. But we had a celebration this week of what they've been doing and the money that they've raised and how they've been giving. But they're really excited about this. So please pray for our Impact Kids. We may have to do some fundraising to raise $900. But God is good. And so we may come knocking at your door with bake sales or something. I don't know. But the kids are really excited about this. So remember them in prayer. If you'd like to help us, of course, we'll take a quarter here, a quarter there, it all adds up. As you can tell, there's lots of things happening, and we have a men's camp meeting this week. There's a board meeting on Wednesday evening. Saturday, we're going to have a packing day out at Big Lake Camp for items going with the Cuba team to Cuba, and we're going to meet there at 1 o'clock. If you have any items for the container for Cuba, we'll be out at camp next Saturday at 1 o'clock. I'll also be out at camp on Tuesday, probably around 10 o'clock, and I'll be out there for most of the morning and part of the afternoon, so probably from 10 until 2, I'll be out at camp. So if anybody has items for the Cuba container and you want to drop it off, then you can do so. That's not listed in your bulletin, but that's one of the things that I'll be doing. Youth rallies coming up, the winter rally, February 24th to the 26th. Cost is $100, and it's being held at the Windsor Church of the Nazarene. So let's pray for our youth who might be going, for the rally, the speakers, as well as if there are youth in our church, I'm sure, who would like to go, who maybe can't afford to go. So again, if you would like to sponsor a youth or provide some funds for them to be able to go, it would greatly be appreciated. We're going to ask our ushers to come forward. We have a potluck this morning for the Cuba team after service. So anyone going to Cuba and your families, you're welcome to join us downstairs. And let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity we have to give. To give back to you, Father, a portion of what you have blessed us with. And Father, we are so blessed. And we pray, Father, that you will take and use this money, that you will multiply it for the use of your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
You bring light to the dark. has christened him.
This one came down New Year's Day. Oh, my word is what I thought, for I really don't talk a lot. When Pastor Mark asked me to write another poem, I knew for sure I was not alone. For our Lord works in mysterious ways. Maybe this is just another way to thank him and give him praise. I can play guitar, but no more can I sing. So to praise God, poetry is my thing. And he deserves to be praised and thanked a lot, for it gives us everything we got. All our little talents and gifts, if you please. We know our Holy Father can do it with ease. He bestows on us what he thinks will help us in this life. You know, take away some of the hard times that are filled with strife. Blessings he gives, and it's up to us to fulfill them. I've always said, and I will forever say, the words of my poetry all come from him. Amen. He gives me a good feeling and helps me on my way. Amen. So let's praise his holy name, Father, Son, and Spirit, the one and the same, the three in one that are all combined. Now I'll close with the rest of mine. So thank you all for listening to me. Drive safe, and to God all praises be. Amen.
Great name, and breathe.
We're going to ask the boys and girls to come on up. We're going to stay up here today, but there's some clipboards up here for you to take, and maybe Pastor Mark, you can pray with them.
We all here? Oh, you're coming too, Carol. Good. How you doing, buddy? Good. Lily, come on in. Come on right over. There you go. Let's hold hands. You want to hold hands? Can I hold your hand, Faith? There we go. You guys going to hold hands?
No.
No? Okay. Yeah, she's pretty cute. You're pretty handsome. All right, well, let's pray then. How'd that be? Okay, let's close our eyes. We'll bow our heads. We'll pray. Our Father, we are thankful, Lord, today for the opportunity that we have to be able to be here and to worship you. Father, I pray that your blessing, that it would rest on these hearts and lives today. Father, we recognize that you have great, great dreams, plans for these. Your word speaks about this. Dreams to give them a future and a hope. And Father, I pray, Lord, that in these days this would be part of the formation of that for them. I ask, Father, that you would meet their needs, keep them safe, guide them in all things. For Father, I commit them, Lord, into your hands. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, if you have your Bibles, let's turn to the book of Acts, chapter 5. I talked about this last Sunday night, as a matter of fact, and I'm reticent to preach the same sermon twice, so hopefully it won't be that. But as I was praying about it all week, you see, and then even right up to last night, I said, Lord, you know, if you had another something else we were going to talk about, that'd be great, because I'm a little hesitant to preach the same sermon twice, and he kept coming back to this particular passage. So that's what we're going to look at. Acts chapter 5, verse 17. We're just going to read down to verse 20 to the end of that. Now let's do 21. Acts chapter 5, beginning to read at verse 17. Then the high priest and all his associates, who were members of the party of the Sadducees, were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles and put them in the public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. Go, stand in the temple courts, he said, and tell the people the full message of this new life. At daybreak, they entered the temple courts, as they had been told, and began to teach the people. Let's pray. Our Father, we are thankful today again, and Lord, we express this over and over again. But Father, it's true. We are thankful. We want to express our thanks to you. Father, you have blessed us in such a multitude of ways. Father, you have blessed us with such wealth and prosperity of spirit and life. That Father, how can we not say to you thanks? Father, I recognize this morning, and I want to say this right up front, Lord, that you are the sovereign King. You are the Creator One, that from the very beginning you brought about the formation of the world and all life as we know it. You are sovereign. You are the Creator. We are the created, and we worship you. We submit ourselves to your authority. We bow before you in awe and adoration and worship. We come into your throne room through the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us. When he died on the cross, Lord, he shed it for us so that we can have access into this throne room of grace to be with you. This was part of your plan. We recognize that. And Father, what can we bring but worship and thankful hearts and adoration? And Father, we recognize, Lord, that you desire fellowship with your people. We recognize, Father, that you desire a relationship with humanity. We recognize, Father, that your Son came so that the broken relationship through sin can be restored through love and obedience of your Son dying on the cross, taking our sins on himself, Lord, that it restores the relationship with you. Father, we come into your presence. Father, you know our hearts, you know our minds, you know what our week has been like. You know that some have had a very difficult week. There's been some trauma. We've been around those that have mourned, those that have wept. And Father, I pray, Lord, that your blessing of peace and your blessing of strength and your blessing of just the powerful presence of who you are, may it settle in on their hearts and lives wherever they're at. Father, we pray, Lord, for those who aren't with us today for reasons of health, sickness. And Father, I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would surround those who are in the hospital. I ask, Father, that you would stretch out your hand and touch them in such a way that they would know your peace and they would know that someone lifts them to your throne today in prayer. Lord, you know who they are and you know what it's all about. Father, I pray, Lord, for these that are here today that are carrying burdens and strife and troubles and Father, problems. And I ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would bless them richly as you set them free. Set them free, Father, from the agony that's in their hearts and spirits today. Father, some are here, and this has been a great week. On the mountain, and wonderful things are happening around them, and people are getting saved, and family things are working out, and relationships are working out. And Father, I pray, Lord, that you would continue to pour out your blessings on these. And Father, many of us are here, and Lord, it's just been a regular week. There's been some good things, there's been some difficult things. It's just been a week. And Father, I pray, Lord, that no matter what the condition of our week has been, Lord, that Father, that we would find ourselves in your presence and we would recognize you clearly. Holy Spirit, speak into our lives individually. Holy Spirit, we recognize that you're sent from the Father through Jesus Christ to speak into our lives that which you hear the Father and the Son talk about. And so I ask in Jesus' name that all the hindrances to our receiving what you've prepared, all these hindrances would be removed and we would know, see, and understand clearly. We loose the kingdom of heaven into this place with greater power and authority over all of our lives in the name of Jesus Christ. Guide us, Father, in these things. We worship you. We submit ourselves to you. Father, we want to bring you honor. Father, I pray, Lord, very humbly, very sincerely, that no word would come from this mouth except it be according to thy will, that you would be glorified. And if it be possible again, Father, clothe yourself with this form that we would know, thus saith the Lord. Father, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm sure you remember the passage that we've read this morning here in Acts chapter 5. It's an interesting one, really, it is. The church is growing, the early church. These followers of Jesus, they were kind of a ragtag bunch of fishermen and carpenters and tax collectors, and some weren't well liked. You know, they sat at the tax tables and they skimmed off the top of taxes and said, you know, your taxes aren't enough. We need to add a little bit more to it. And so everyone knew what they were doing, you know. But these were the ragtag bunch that Jesus said, come, follow me. I'm going to make you something. I'm going to make you fishers of men. So they did. And you know how the story went. You know, they followed Jesus for 3 years, and then Jesus was taken by the authorities, and he was tried, and he was put on a cross, and he was crucified. You remember all of that happened there, and you remember how at noonday the sky went black. You remember that the veil of the temple was torn right from top to the bottom. You remember the Bible, it talks about it, that the dead, the saints and the holy ones, they rose up out of the grave and they wandered the streets for a number of days, you know, talking about this stuff. And now this is only 6 months later, no more than that, that we have now the early church has begun its journey. It was 40 days after the resurrection of the dead, only 40 days, so that's 10 days, that's a month plus 10 days. So let's say that the crucifixion and resurrection happened in the summertime. We'll say that, you know, what's 6 months from January, what's that would be August, wouldn't it? July, August, something like that. So let's say that that in July, all this stuff happened. So then in about the first part of September, Jesus rose from the dead. He was gone. He was crucified. You know, it was 40 days and all this stuff happened. And now he's at the Pentecost event. And he's saying, wait here in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father. And then you will be witnesses unto me to the uttermost parts of the earth, Judea, Samaria, you know, and you can read about that in Acts chapter 1. So this now has been going on, and it's only been, it hasn't been a year. It's only been a few months. And situations are happening, you know, and we talked about this a number of weeks ago in Acts chapter 5, verse 12, you know, there, and following down to that, that it says there in verse 15 that as a result of everything that the Holy Spirit was doing in the church, as a result, Peter were bringing their sick and their demon-possessed people and their crippled and everybody else, and they would line the streets of where he was going so that his shadow would fall on them and they would be healed. Now, this is the same Peter who denied Jesus in the same city. We talked about this on Friday night, and it would kind of be like, you know, here in Oxford back in the summer. Let's say that back in the summer, we had the whole crucifixion event happen here. And as part of the crucifixion event, you know, pretend I was Peter. I don't really want to be Peter, but let's pretend I was Peter. And I was really troubled about everything that was happening. So I remember that I said to Jesus, I said, you know, Lord, I will never leave you. And so I go down there and I knock on the gate, and Thomas or John, the beloved, he's already inside, and they're not harassing him. But the gal that opens the gate, she was there, and I was there, and I went in, and she looked at me kind of funny, and I kind of thought, well, what's all this about? But this was only in August, right? Only September-ish, only a few months ago. And she said, you're one of his followers, aren't you? And I said, I'm not one of his followers. What do you think you're talking about? And I want to, you know, no. I'm just here to get warm by the fire. That's all I'm here for. Then she went over. I could see her going over there and talking to somebody else. And over she went. And then her, the little kid, and some of the, you know, some other brat person come over here, and they said, we're sure that you're one of his. You were there, da, 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 da. And I said, listen, you guys go over and mind your own business. I'm just here getting warmed by the fire, and I don't want to have anything to do with this. I'm not, you know, and you know, things go. So they're over there talking away, and somebody comes over, and he's missing an ear. You remember what happened? Yeah, I was the guy who cut this high priest servant's ear off. He looks at me, he says, you know what? You did this. This is the evidence. And then I swore up and down a blue streak. And I said, I am not one of his. Fast forward 6 months. No, it was September, October, November, December. Fast forward 4 months. Only 4 months have passed. And now I'm the same guy, and they're putting their sick on the street. I'm trying to go to the IGA up there, and I can't get through because all of a sudden everywhere I go, there's a big crowd all around there. And I said, just mind your own business. I'm just going to get some apples. I'm just going to get a loaf of bread, you know. And people are just, they're jumping up all around. They're getting healed. It says here, as a result. It says that in verse 15 of Acts chapter 5. Notice there. As a result of what? As a result of what the Holy Spirit was doing in the apostles' lives at this moment, that was only 3 or 4 months after Jesus ascended. As a result, stuff was happening around the city, the same city in which Jesus was crucified. As a result, stuff was happening in their lives. You see, once God begins to move, it doesn't take very long for things to happen. Once God begins to change a heart and a life, it doesn't take very long for people to recognize something is different about you. I don't know, you got a new cologne maybe, you got a new tie, you got a new suit, you got your hair cut. What is it? I don't know what it is, but you know what it is, that the Holy Spirit is doing a work in you and it's spilling out all around you. So we come to the passage then that we just read, Acts 5:17. So the people who were supposed to have the presence of God, who didn't have the presence of God, became jealous. Right? Listen to me now. The people who were supposed to have the presence of God that did not have the presence of God became jealous. And so instead of going to them and saying, you know, what is this about you? You know, tell us the story. Help us to find the same thing. Instead of doing that, they said, we're going to shut this whole system down. We're going to bring a stop to this. We're going to put these guys in jail. We're gonna beat them senseless, and we're gonna exert our authority that we have humanly and politically here. So that's what they did. Notice there, verse 17. Then the high priest and all his associates who were members of the party of the Sadducees were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles. They put them in the public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail, brought them out. Go and stand in the temple courts, he said, and tell the people the full message of this new life. Now, this is a pretty powerful thing right here that's happened. We see that at daybreak they went and they entered the temple courts. Verse 21, you know, you can read it. They did as they had been told. They began to teach the people. But then halfway through verse 21, another interesting thing, there's a couple stories that are happening here. Halfway through verse 21, it says that when the high priest and his associates arrived, they called together the Sanhedrin, which is the full assembly of the elders of Israel. They sent to the jail for the apostles, but on arriving at the jail, the officers did not find them there. So they went back and reported, we found the jail securely locked with the guards standing at the doors, but when we opened them, there was no one inside. Now, how would you like to be that guard working at Spring Hill Prison, and you're standing, where are you going, Ken? Speaking of Spring Hill Prison, not talking about you. Or maybe I am. But I mean, how would you like to be that guard? You know, you're standing there and you're on guard and you're supposed to be guarding that, and the authorities come up to collect the prisoner out of the cell, and you're standing there, you know, right attention, you're here and someone else is over here and the two of you are there, and yes sir, and you salute and all that, and we've come to get these two guys out of jail, and okay, everything's secure, and they unlock it. They open it up and they look in, and the guy comes back out. He says, what? Is this kind of something kind of a joke? Where are the people? Well, they're right inside. No one's come. No one's gone. They're right inside. There's nobody in there. Can you imagine what that would mean to those who were there? That'd be a little embarrassing, wouldn't it? Well, can you imagine going back then and reporting that to the Sanhedrin? You know, the powerful people of Jerusalem had gathered as part of the gathering of the elders of Israel. They were all there. This high court, the Supreme Court of Canada, had all gathered, and you got to be the guy to go in and say, you know what? They're not anywhere to be found, but the door was locked. You know, it kind of makes me think. I think the angels have a sense of humor. Like, why would they relock the door? Why wouldn't they, you know, at least throw the guards into the jail cell and make it look like they broke out? But, you know, but instead they you know, in the middle of the night, isn't that not what it says? It says they were arrested, the apostles put them in punishment. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors. So in the middle of the night, you know, you can just picture, can't you? In the middle of the night, the angel of the Lord came down. And the lock turns and the door swings open, and there's the angel of the Lord, and he says to those guys inside, he says, come on, but be very quiet, because we're going to pull a prank on the guards standing here. You know, and so out they go, and he says, okay, just a minute, shh, and very quietly he shuts it, you know, and the guards standing there, and maybe they're nodding off or something, and he locks it. This is going to be great come the morning. We're all kind of waiting to see what happens, you know, and he locks it, and away they go. He says, now tomorrow what we want you to do, what the plan is not to run away. What we want you to do is you guys then go to the temple and just start preaching. It's going to be great, because the cell's going to be empty. They're going to think you're there. Nobody's going to know, but you guys are going to be preaching, and we're all going to be watching to heaven. It seems like somebody's got a sense of humor. In the passage here that they, I want to quickly go through the end of this. Because they collect them back in verse 26. You can read about this. When the captain of the guard went in, his officers, they found them in the temple. They didn't use force because they feared that the people would stone them. But they brought the apostles. They made them appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. And they said, we gave you strict orders not to teach in his name. Yet you filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. And Peter replied, he said, well, we must obey God rather than men. And then when he went in to talk about verse 30, you can read about it. It says, the God of our fathers raised Jesus from the dead, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him to his own right hand as prince and savior, that he might give repentance and forgiveness of sins to Israel. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were furious. They wanted to put them to death. And that's when Gamaliel stood up. And that's where we come into that whole, that fairly famous passage where he said, be careful what you do, because you may find yourselves fighting against God himself. If this is of men, it's going to die out. If it's of God, it's not going to die out, and you'll find yourself fighting against God. That's kind of the gist of that. Two things that the Holy Spirit spoke to me very clearly about this week. I didn't write it down, but two distinct things he spoke to me about this week that were fairly significant to me. The first one was this. They arrested the apostles, and they put them in the public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. And he said, go stand in the temple courts and tell the people the full message of this new life. And I thought the first thing the Holy Spirit spoke to me was about this, about when the world tries to lock away the message of the gospel. It tries to lock away and say, you know what, we don't want you to talk about this. Well, who says that? Well, a lot of times it's people who know what it is that you're saying, but they don't want to hear it. But it's not all the world that says that, because the world gathered into the temple, and they were so intent on listening to the message that they were saying that the captain of the guards, they were afraid of getting stoned had they used any kind of force or violence and even pushed those guys to go into the Sanhedrin. They would be killed because the world wanted the message. But the people who didn't want the message were the ones who should have known the message, but they didn't have the message, and so they were jealous because of the message. Now, we would never experience that. But I'll tell you what we do experience. Being locked in a prison where the message doesn't reach the audience it's intended to reach. Sometimes we're locked in a prison of our past. Let's say that. Peter began the journey of prisons, and he toured a lot of prisons. Paul and Silas, you know, we know the story about that in Acts, and well, they were singing it at night. You know, they understand the country of prisons. They understand the culture of prisons. And I suspect Peter was kind of locked in the prison of his past when Jesus met him by the seashore before Pentecost. And the prison of his past was when he had denied Jesus, exactly as we began. You know, he said to the gatekeeper there, the little girl that came in and said, you're one of his. And he said, I'm not. And then three times, so Jesus met him to deliver him out of the prison of his past. And then he said to Peter, okay, Peter, I know that you've done a lot of failing here in Jerusalem, but this is where I want you to stay until the Holy Spirit comes on you. And then you can be a witness to me and to all the world. But for right now, we're going to solve the problem of the prison of the past. What's the prison of your past? Prison of your past is where maybe you've said or done or acted or something's happened that has kind of given you a sense of compromise in the past, you know? And the enemy uses that. And you can, I tell you how you find the prison of your past is because you begin talking about or thinking about something God is calling you to, and all of a sudden there's somebody on your shoulder, and they say, and the whispers, into your ear, and says, you don't remember this? Remember what happened? Remember what you said? Remember what you did? Remember what you thought? You know, and the prison of the past, the doors loom open, and you have a choice in that moment, either to keep your mouth shut, hide away in that prison, or walk through the doors and say, you know what? I've been delivered, and I'm going to tell you why. See, part of the delivery of the prison here is this. In Acts chapter 5, verse 17 and following there, Acts chapter 19, notice what it says. It says, during the night. The night is a dark time. Why wasn't it during the day? They could have done it during the day just as well as the night, right? You agree with me, Marion? Yeah, I appreciate that, because I would have to argue with you if you didn't, so I appreciate that you did. So it was during the night, but the night is a dark time. A night is a time when all your fears are magnified, and if you're going to worry, you're going to worry before you go to sleep, or wake up in the middle of the night because you can't sleep, and you're going to worry. It was a dark time. The angel of the Lord opened the door. Now they had a choice, right? They had a choice. The door was open. I wondered to myself, maybe if they might have said, you know what, not what I thought. I kind of thought that when I became a Christian, all my problems go away. This is not what I thought. You know, here I am in jail. I'm just going to suffer through this. I'm going to get beat tomorrow. I know what they do, and I'm just going to go on my way. But that's not what they did. They came out. They had the choice. When God opens the door, you have a choice about whether or not to go through it. And so they got up and they went through it. They shut the door behind them, signifying that, you know what, they didn't want to have any more to do with the prison of their past. And they were going through it. And then the angel said to them, he said this, now you want to come over the traumas of the prison of your past. This is how you do it. And then it's very clear. He said, go, stand in the temple courts. And then, now listen. He said, tell the people the full message of this new life. Whose new life? Well, your new life. Tell the people the full message of this new life. Well, what do you mean? Well, what I mean is this. you know what it's like growing up in a town. I grew up here. People, you know, remember things, and I every once in a while I talk to somebody from a long time ago. And they say, you remember when? And I say, yeah, I remember when. They say, you know, wasn't that a lot of fun? Oh, no, that wasn't such fun. Now that I think about it, it was rather stupid, tell you the truth. You know, and you know, but you know, there's a past. And people would say sometimes, I don't know, maybe they say it to you. They'd say, you know, you smoke. No smoke. No. I bet you're a Christian. That's why you don't. And you know what my response is now? Yeah, I am a Christian, but that's not why I don't smoke. That's not why I don't do anything like that. You know why I don't do that? Because back then, I was empty. I was just empty. I said, you can't, you know, and if they're going to bring it up, don't you think I'm not going to push it? You know, and back then, I was empty. I was like everybody else, you know, and don't you remember? And I remember having a conversation with somebody. I looked him right in the eye. I called him right by a certain name, which was his name. You know, I called him right by a name, and I said, you know what? You know, you remember what it was like, and you remember the next day, you know, you kind of be embarrassed or kind of, you know, what did I do, you know, and all that stuff. And there was an emptiness to it. Well, I'm not empty. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, but I found life. It's a new life. There's nothing I can't do. I just don't want to. Why do I do that? I don't want to do that. It's not even fun. The jokes I used to think were funny, they're not even funny anymore. You know, why would I even want to do that? I found life. I've drunk of the water that satisfies my soul. Why would I even want to bother with that trash? It's stupid. This is the new life. This is the full message of the new life. You know, for the first little while, you know, their mouth was open and closing, nothing coming out. So I jumped right in and said, I'm going to tell you something. This is how it is. You can talk about religion. You can talk about church. You can talk about all the bad things in all the world because of religion and the fightings and wars and crusades, blah, 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 blah. But I'm going to tell you this. Jesus made a difference in my life. That's the end of that story right there. You can believe it. You cannot believe it. I don't really care because once I was blind, now I can see, and that's the evidence right there. That's the full message of this new life. Right? That's all there is. You see, here when I was kind of reading through this and getting ready for this, you know, over in John, if you have your Bible, just flip over to John for a minute. There's a passage here, John chapter 15. John chapter 15, And down, oh, where are we at? John chapter 15. Oh, there it is. It's last verse, verse 27. But you know what? Let's look at verse 26. John chapter 15, verse 26, down to the end of that. It says this. It says, when the counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And then he says this. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. You also, when the Holy Spirit comes, he's going to testify about Christ. But he says, but Jesus then says, now when he's there, you also need to testify about me because you have been with me from the beginning. Now, we haven't been with Jesus from the beginning of time. That was 2,000 years ago. But if we if we combine that with Acts chapter 5, the one that we read, where he said, go and tell the people the full message of this new life, what I'm going to suggest to you is happening here. What he's saying here is this. He says, the Holy Spirit comes. The Holy Spirit fills your life. And you can say, well, you know what, I don't this and I don't that. That's okay. You know, you can, whatever. The Holy Spirit comes into your life. You ask Jesus into your heart. He takes away your sin, first of all. Remember we talked about that, the house of preparation. He prepares you. To as many as received him, gave he power to them to become children of God. The Bible's very clear about this. You know, that Jesus prepares us. He gives us power to become. It's his blood. It washes away our sin. It makes us clean. The guilt is gone. You know, he takes it all away and we become new. And then he gives us the Holy Spirit, which is power. You know, that's the house of power before we move into the house of purpose. Because in the time of the house of power, he witnesses about God. He witnesses about Jesus to us. We have all kinds of questions. We say, well, Lord, what about that? What about this? What about my sin? And what about what I did there? What about did there? And he says to us, he said, you know, it's all washed away in the blood that flows from Calvary. It's all washed away and you're free. What am I free to? You're free to do whatever you want. You're free. And then he goes on, he says, now you need to be witnesses to me. Right? In John chapter 15, we read it there. In Acts chapter 1, we read it there. You know, I'm close enough to it. Let me just turn over to Acts chapter 1. I think it's about verse 8. It says there, it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. You will be my witnesses. And so here in Acts chapter 5, it's reinforced again. He says, tell the people the full message of this new life. Now, what this doesn't mean is that you're going to have all the answers to all the problems theologically for the rest of your life. It doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean when someone says to you, he said, what do you do about the problem and the origin of evil and sin? I don't know. What do you do about it? I tell you what I do know. Once I was blind, now I can see. I tell you what I do know. Once I was a cripple sitting alongside the road and now I can walk. Do I know how he did it? Do I know how the molecules changed? Do I know how calcium flowed in my bones and the muscles all attached? I got no sweet clue. But I'll tell you this. I once was broken. Now I'm made whole. That's it. And I'll tell you something else. I know who did it. Jesus Christ did it. And you know, and then the Sadducees and the Pharisees came back to the same guy who was blind, that was just referring to there, and they said, well, praise God, we know the guy's a sinner. He said, I don't really care what you know. I don't know anything about that. You want to know what I'm testifying of? You want to know the message of God in my heart today was once I was this, now I'm this. This is the full message of my new life. You don't got to know all the answers. You just have to know what God has done in you. The end. I have to breathe every once in a while. I'm on a hurry to get to heaven, but you know. The prison. They were delivered out of it. So I was praying this week and saying, Lord, you know, what are we going to talk about? And you know, how it goes. And he says, oh, this is what I want you to talk about. And then I want you to talk about being set free. I want you to talk about helping people get out of the prison. And I said, I don't know a whole lot about that. I know that it happens, but I don't know, you know, what does that mean? He said, well, I know a lot about that, and I want to help some people to be set free. You see, sometimes the prisons that we're locked into are ones that they're boxes that the world puts around us. And the prison that's spoken of here, it's a physical place. It says they arrested, verse 18 of Acts chapter 5, they arrested the apostles, they put them in the public jail. It speaks of a type, it speaks of a location, it speaks of a facility. It says in the middle of the night, then they were delivered. But then also it comes back to us, you know, the other part that we read, verse 27, following down from there. They brought them before the Sanhedrin, and they were about to put them into another prison, but it was a prison of their words. It wasn't the facility of stone and iron. It was a prison of their words. And what they said was, we gave you strict orders not to teach in his name. We gave you strict orders not to speak about him. We gave you strict orders to do this, to do that, to do something else. It was a prison that bound them down by their words. They said, you know what? I know that you want to lock us away. Now notice what they said, verse 29. But we must obey God rather than men. We have to. The key to my freedom is obedience to God. The key to your freedom is obedience to God. Well, see, what does that mean in my life, though? You know, I want to talk about God at home, work, at the gas station, at Tim Hortons. I want to be free. You hear the words we're saying? I want to be free to speak about the kingdom. I want to be free, you know, to have my voice loose so that I could speak the word of God. I want to be free so that people would hear. I want to be free so that I don't feel that, you know, I'm whatever. But the reality is it comes down to this. Freedom comes through obedience to God. Jesus, a number of times, gave parables of the talents. Remember that? You know, you're trusted with a little, you'll be given more. You know, that's kind of how it works. And so sometimes we are given a small message, and you know what that is. The world around us wants to lock you away in a prison. Just don't, you know, we don't talk. I always get myself in trouble. That's okay. I was at a hardware store, not in this particular town, but I was at a hardware store. And all I said was, well, we're just chatting. I said, oh, but what church do you go to? Well, the guy got really upset. All I said was, what church do you go to? I wasn't, you know, saying you should come to my church. I didn't even have a Bible in my hand. You know, I just said, well, you know, we were just talking. I said, well, what church do you go to? This is what he said. He said, that's absolutely none of your business. He said, that's kind of like asking how I vote. Well, that was going to be my next question, you know, but... I guess I'm not being that next question now, but he got really upset, you know, and I couldn't. I just asked you where you go to church. I mean, you know, I'm not going to say that's good, bad, or anything. I was just going, well, that's nice, you know, good for you. And but right away there was a sense of constriction that was okay. We're going to lock that away, right? The prisons either lock you in or lock you out. That's going to, you know, we're going to lock that away. So. Guess what I did for the next 6 months? I went to see him every week. Oh, yeah, I did. but it was, you know, I didn't want to be mean or anything, but I thought, you know, that was a really strange response, and I'd like to find out why that was. You know, has he been hurt by a church? Did somebody say something, do something? And I just wanted to find that out. So I pray every time before I go. You know, by the time we moved away from that town, we were best friends. We were just really good friends. We could talk about anything, and I would leave there saying, you know what, before I go, would it be okay for me to pray with you? And he said, I sure wish you would. That was kind of how that worked there in the end. But you have to be obedient to God. Not abrasive, not ignorant, not nasty, but obedient to God. That's the key to getting out of the prison. Sometimes, though, our prison is not the prison of public opinion. It's the prison of addictions. It's the prison of habits. It's the prison of pain. It's the prison of what life has dealt to you in the past. It's the prison of situations that have really scarred your life, and you're trying to get close to God, and you're trying to be a witness of God and to God in the world around you, but every time you begin that, you feel such agony and pain and condemnation from something inside or outside or something. You know, there is deliverance for you in the name of Jesus Christ. I struck on something this morning. We were worshiping, and God said to me about a verse, and I had to look it up in my Bible. So I wasn't actually on Facebook. I was looking up a verse in my Bible here. It says this from John chapter 8, verse 36. You'll know it. It says, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. You know that verse. If the Son shall make you free, you will be free indeed. Man, do you want to be free? Is there something in your life that you want to be free of? You feel that you're kind of inside a blocked wall, a shut door. You can't get through. You can't find your way out. Do you want to be free? He has promised. Let me read it for you again. If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. I'm going to close with this one last question. How free is freedom? You've asked that question of yourself, right? How free is freedom? Does anybody know the answer? Freedom is free, right? If you're free, you're free to make mistakes. Okay, make your mistakes. If you're free, you're free to go. You're free to return. You're free to go here, to go there. You're free. You're free. See, the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness is that in the kingdom of God, you're free. It's a money-back guarantee. If you don't like it, go back to what it was. If you don't like how God fills your heart and life, if you don't like the joy, the peace he gives, you know, go back to your old miserable existence. Away you go. You know, just do it. You know, wake up every day. I hope today is a great day to be miserable because I'm going to be miserable because I like it. You know, but freedom is free. Now I'll tell you something else. If you get addicted to fentanyl, you get addicted to crack cocaine, you're not free. You're not. Unless God delivers you, you will struggle with that addiction for the rest of your life. You can't go back because that's the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. Kingdom of darkness puts chains on you that you cannot be free of outside of God's help. And God said, I will set you free. And if I set you free, you will be free indeed. Man, that's something to shout about. You will be free. There's no downside to this. You don't lose. You can't lose. And then, go tell the people the full message of your new life. Once I was lost, now I'm found. Once I was blind, now I see. Once I lived life in discouragement and depression, but now there is a joy that floods my soul. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. It should be a song, shouldn't it? We should make a song like that. Well, God desires to set you free. He told me that. He told me that. Let's pray. Our Father, we're thankful, Lord, for the opportunity that we have in these days, Lord, to know your presence. And Father, we recognize that you are the sovereign King of all that is. Lord, there's no one like you. You are the Creator God. You are moving through the world in this time for such a time as this. And Father, very clearly, very distinctly, I sensed you say to me, even as late as last night, that if there are those who want to be set free, that today there is the day that they can be set free. And so, Father, I pray as we sing this last song, that you would do whatever you desire to do. Speak into their hearts. And Father, maybe as we're singing, if they just want to stand and lift their hearts to you and say, Lord, set me free. I pray, Father, that your freedom would be poured out upon this place, that your grace would fill these hearts, that your peace would overwhelm folks, that Lord, that there would be such a sense of who you are. We wouldn't be trapped in our past. We wouldn't be trapped in an addiction. We wouldn't be trapped in bad habits. We wouldn't be trapped in the stuff of life. We wouldn't be trapped by other people's opinions. But Father, we would be set free and we would have a testimony of what you have done, the full message of this new life. Guide us, Father, as we sing this last song. This is your time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together while we sing, can we?
We were going to finish with a different song, but I thought all I could think was the sermon is that no matter what happens, what prisons we're in, that God is fighting for us. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved in Jesus' name.
We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus.
Father, it is in the name of Jesus Christ that we recognize our freedom. We recognize our deliverance. We recognize there's power to break every chain. And Father, I pray, Lord, for each one who's gathered here. I ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit, that it would speak deeply into our lives and grant to us that freedom, Lord, that you have spoken about, that we so desire. I pray, Father, for those that struggle with issues in their life of past or present addictions or difficult things, Lord, that whirl around them, that bind them up. I ask, Father, for freedom. I ask, Father, for deliverance. I ask, Father, for that healing touch in their hearts and lives, that, Father, that they would be whom you have created them to be. Father, I pray that in these moments, Lord, that your glory would surround each one with strength and authority and liberty. Father, I commit them into your hands. Lead us, Lord, as we go from this place or as some remain to pray or to worship. But, Father, whatever happens, Lord, we ask that you would guide us, go with us, keep us safe, help us to be obedient to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.